Check. 1, 2. Can you hear me now? That sounds pretty funny. Okay, let's check it now. See if you can hear me okay. Can you hear me now? Please tell me you can hear me now. Jake can hear me. John can hear me. Yes. All right. Awesome. Cool. Cool. Yeah, it seems like the video stream is doing pretty well because I can monitor it from here, and it seems like it's doing pretty good. The audio. hey, everybody. It's so nice to hear from you all. And I'm hoping I can see some of your faces in real life at the IGPA. I don't know who will be there, but I thought what I'll do is I'll start off by telling you a little bit about what I got going on here for these webinars. Now I see it's glitching just a little bit. Yeah, well, we'll keep going anyway. So, Marilyn, you don't have a picture? Check. 1, 2, 3. Hey, everybody. Please let me know if you can see and hear me okay. Thank you, Joe. Joe says, sweet guitar. Brian says, nothing. Guys, if you don't have something, because most people can see and hear me, if you don't have something, drop the call and then come back on again, okay? So if you can't see me or you can't hear me or your internet, it's not syncing quite, what usually happens with these programs is it takes about a minute or two for it to balance out. I don't know exactly the way this works, but with compression and stuff, it takes a little bit to balance out. So if you're having a problem, Vic says he's good, John says he's good, William says he's good, Charles says he's good, Mike's all good. But if you are having a problem, wait a couple of minutes. If you can see me and hear me, but it's not connecting, wait a couple of minutes for the buffer to work. If you can't see me or you can't hear me, then you can drop the call and then come back and it should work okay. So just so you guys know, I'm using this gem today because my other gem is on its way to Nashville. So I shipped it today. I am not quite ready to put that guitar on an airplane today. And to be honest with you, I got to put it on an airplane anyway. I got something else to tell you. But I've got so much stuff that I got to bring that I didn't want to bring a flight case and all the other bags that I got to bring. So, Brian, if you're still having a problem, log off and log back on and see if it's better, because everybody else seems like they're doing okay with that. So, here's the deal. I'm using this guitar because my other guitar is on its way to Nashville. I'm going to be using my black gem that you've probably seen in a number of my videos. I'll be using that one, and you guys are more than welcome to have a look at it. I think I'm going to bring it out Friday night and then let you mess with it a little bit if you want to. So, Brian says I sound like the Iron Man intro. Let me try this. I am Iron Man. See if that helped, Brian. So, Brian, if it does happen, if it happens, log off and then log back on. Maybe try a different browser. I know, Michael. Yeah, I use Chrome 90% of the time, and it seems to work pretty well. But even though I'm using Google Hangouts, it doesn't mean Chrome always works. So sometimes I do different things. But anyway, so that's why I'm using this guitar. I'm running this into an 11 rack right now, which is running out to a mixer, which is then running into my my audio interface. That's how I'm doing this. That way, I don't have a separate guitar channel and a separate vocal channel and that sort of thing. I can mix them all, and then I can send it to you that way. And it seems to work a little bit better. Thank you, Jose. Jose says it's working pretty good. The members-only guitar strap, Jim. I think I've told you the story about these guitar straps, but I have these made. There's a gentleman that is in our GuitarZoom community, and his name is Tom Robbins. And Tom Robbins' wife makes me these straps, and they are by far the most comfortable straps I have ever had in my entire life. So I literally have them on every guitar that I play live. They're the strap that I use for everything. So she makes me all kinds of different styles of them, but they're super comfortable. For those of you that have played out on stage before, you know that, like for me, it always winds up coming up against my neck here, and it winds up, you know, scratching against there because I'm always headbanging and all that sort of thing. And they're just not very comfortable. These, I don't know what it is about these straps, so that's why I use these, okay? Because I really love them. So, well, June says, and I'm going to get to all your questions here, just kind of tell you what I got for a setup here. So when I normally do my recording, I don't do this, but what I found is running it into the 11 rack and then running it into the mixer and then running it into the computer tends to work a little bit better. So guys, at some point I'm planning on making a video that shows you how all my setup stuff works here. But I just haven't gotten there. But I'm telling you, I don't know that Tom Robbins is, I'm going back to these guitar straps here. I don't know if his wife makes them for sale, but I'm telling you, they could be the best looking or the ugliest straps in the world, and I would still use them on stage because they're so comfortable. And I've always thought it's so weird. It's like, for me, it's like Kiss. Kiss is the most marketable band on the planet, but they still can't really figure out how to do perfect marketing. You know, they sell coffins for $7,000 and all this or more. And guitar straps for me have always been that way. It's like nobody really makes the perfect guitar strap. I'm telling you, these are the best guitar straps by far I have ever had. Okay? So, guys, can you hear me okay? And if you can't, I'm going to switch to a different audio. So if for some reason the audio is not working, we'll give it just a minute here. And let me know if it's getting better. And if it's not getting better, I will switch. Okay? Okay? So audio is weird. Okay? And Jim says audio is weird. Just do what I can. This whole thing. Frustrating, these webinars. We've tried so many different things. Okay, so Shar and a couple other people have asked. Let's see, switch. Getting worse. Okay, hold on, give me a second. All right, can you hear my voice? Hold on a second. Can you hear my voice? Is this any better? Check one, two. Check one, two. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Check one, two. Oh my gosh. Okay, I'll give you a minute. Sorry, I don't know what the problem is. Check one, two. I'll give you a minute. Tell me if the audio is better. Okay, Brian says vid is good. Voice is fine. Vid just got fuzzy. Voice is good. Yeah, much better. Okay. Better now. Okay, good. I'm using a Yeti over here. So that's what I'm using. So just kind of focus on my voice as best you can. And I'm telling you, I've had it with these webinars. They just drive me freaking up the wall. So do the best you can with the voice for now, and I'll talk to you guys, and I'll do the video as best I can as the feed gets a little bit better. So so here's the deal. Okay, Paul says excellent. That's good. Okay. So anyway, about the IGPA, first of all, here's the setup. For those of you that are coming, Friday night will be a meet and greet. You'll be able to, Griff Hamlin will be there, if you know who Griff is. Griff will be there. Glenn Drover will be there from Megadeth. Dan will be there, and I will be there. Okay? Yeah, Vic says, I get my responses minutes after you post them. It takes about a minute to feed to everybody. When you have like 200 people on a call, it takes about a minute to feed to everybody. Okay? So, anyway, so Friday night, we'll all be there. Here's the schedule for, let's see. Anyone has issues? Okay. Matt, since you're there, Matt, can you hear my voice okay now? Because I'm using a different thing. I went to something else. I'm just waiting for Matt to let me know if it seems like it's working okay. Yes, except I'm doubled again. Oh, I hate this. Here, let me try one more thing. See if this helps any. Okay, so I changed one other setting. Let's see if that might help the audio a little bit. I'm most concerned with the audio right now. Okay, so Matt can hear me good. And then Matt, just let me know how the video looks as well. And then I'll deal with that. But okay, so Friday night, 7 to 10, meet and greet. It's at the Marriott downtown. It's called Marriott Nashville downtown. That's where it is, okay? And then the second thing is on Saturday, the classes will be held from 9 until 5, okay? We will take an hour lunch break in between, but we'll have 9 to 5, okay? And what's going to happen is Griff is going to go first thing in the morning. Griff's going to do a class with you from 9 until 10:30, okay? And then after that, we'll take like a 15-minute break or so, and then Glenn's going to do a class with you, and that's going to go from around 11 to 12:30, somewhere right around there. We'll figure it out. I mean, it's just us, so we can do it. And then we'll take lunch, so around 12:30 to 1:30, we'll take lunch, and then we'll come back. And at 1:30 through the afternoon, it will be you and me, okay? And I got all kinds of fun things planned for us to jam together. So today I rented some gear. So I'll have a couple of guitars. I'll have a couple of amps available. So you can plug into whatever. You can use whatever guitar you want. I've got a Fender Strat coming, and I've got a Paul Reed Smith coming. I've got a Fender Blues Deluxe, I think, amp coming. And then I've got a Marshall TSL coming. Okay, yeah, you guys are on your own for lunch. Yeah. Yeah, I'd love to take you out for lunch, but then I wouldn't have enough money to get home. So yeah, I don't know what we're doing for lunch. I don't even know what I'm doing. I'm going down on Wednesday actually to scope the place out to kind of see what's around, what's available. And then I got to pick up all the gear. I got to set up the stage, all that kind of stuff. Yeah, John, I've heard about your situations. That's too bad. I really am sorry you won't be there, John. No, you don't have to bring guitars, guys. Nobody needs to bring a guitar. Okay? Yeah. Nobody needs to bring a guitar. You don't need to bring a guitar. I'll have stuff there. Okay? And then here's the other deal is I will be bringing cameras for recording the IGPA. I just don't know how much of it I will get recorded. I can't get, you know, the entire day recorded, I don't think. I don't have anybody set up to do the recording. But I will try and get the most important parts recorded, our clips throughout the day. For those of you that can't come, you'll be able to watch some of that. You know, I'll have to go through it and edit it and figure out the best parts of everything. But anyway, that's what we'll be doing. So that's what Saturday is going to have in store. So from 9 to 5, we'll have classes with us three guitar players. And then you will not need to bring guitars, amps, anything like that. You can use the stuff that we have. Can you bring beer, Mark? Well, you can buy beer on Friday. I don't know about Saturday. I don't know if they allow that or not. But, will the classes be geared to complete beginners? No, June, they're not going to be, June says, are the classes going to be geared to complete beginners? They're not going to be geared towards any beginner or advanced or anything. They're going to be topical, right? So Griff is going to be talking about the blues because that's his thing. And he's going to be giving you a lot of insight and, you know, playing tips, practicing tips, things like that, you know, concept things, lots of different stuff like that. And Glenn will be doing the same thing, but more on the rock level. But he'll be, you know, telling you a little bit about his history and playing and performing and all that sort of thing. And then mine is going to be a bit more personable. Mine is my section, which is going to be for, you know, what are we looking at? 2:30, 3:30, 4:30. You know, 3 hours or so, you and I are going to be spending the time together, like really talking and figuring out what it is that you need, your direction, you know, what I can do to help you personally, just like I would do in a private one-on-one lesson, what I can do for that. So attendees, John, I would think attendees are probably somewhere, I think it's somewhere around 60 or 70 people are going, somewhere around there. I'm not exactly sure. I don't know what the last headcount was because I haven't really been working on that end of things, but I think it's somewhere around there. So, but yeah,
No, I mean, the whole thing about this is to make sure that it's beneficial for everybody who attends, and you know, it's not stressful, anything like that. And then Shane says, when will the next one be? The next one would be next year. We're planning on doing them annually. I don't know any details about that, but I do know that we will be hiring somebody to take care of the details. So that'll be good. But yeah, it'll just be awesome. It'll be a really nice opportunity to hang out and just work one-on-one as best we can with everybody. So I'll have some handouts for you. We've got some gifts that we're giving you. You'll get a gift bag with some stuff in there, things like that. And like I said, Friday will be fun because we'll just hang out and get to know each other. We're going to chat. And like I said, if my guitar shows up in time, I thought about bringing it up there. And that way, you know, people could plug into it and jam a little bit if they wanted to or whatever. That might be kind of fun. Just please be careful with it because I love it. But I'm sure you will. I trust you all. And then the other thing I was going to tell you too is I found out today that I can now announce that I'm going to be going on tour for the month of November with a band called Grim Reaper. Now, I don't know if anybody out there knows who Grim Reaper is, but Grim Reaper was an 80s band, a metal band, the new wave of British heavy metal, the second generation of new wave British heavy metal. They were part of that. And their big song was called See You in Hell, and it went like this. Okay. And in a stroke of fate, the guitar or the singer for Grim Reaper and I wound up meeting at a show quite a few years back. And he and I became really, really close. And I was the best man at his wedding and he was the best man at my wedding. And he's my, my youngest girl. He's his, he is her godfather. So anyway, they're coming over. They're on tour right now across the States and Canada. And in November, their guitar player has to go back to the UK. And so I'm going to fill in for the month and tour with them. I don't know what the schedule is, but I know it's all over the place. So I'm hoping that if you go to the Grim Reaper website or Steve Grimmett or whatever, you can find the calendar. And maybe we're coming somewhere where I can see you again and you can come in and watch me play live. So for the last 4 days now, I've been trying to prepare for this IGP. I'm not trying to talk your ears off, guys. Just telling you kind of what's going on here. But for the last 4 days, I've been trying to prep for this IGPA thing, and then I'm trying to learn all of their frickin' material. Because, and that's what I was going to kind of, I'm going to make some videos on this stuff too, but which I've already started kind of making. But when you play with a band like this, you have a limited amount of time. Like I have 2 weeks to get prepared. I have 17 songs to learn, but it's not just a matter of learning the 17 songs. It's that we won't have any rehearsals. So I have to walk in and play. So I have to learn how they start songs, how they stop songs, if they segue songs together, if there are parts that are different than the albums, all that sort of thing. And that's what I want to kind of bring you in on is understanding kind of how that works. And they have a tour bus, which we'll be traveling around in, and it's literally all over the country. So I'm hoping that that I'll be able to see you while I'm out on tour somewhere. And once I get more details on the calendar and all that, I can post it. I just found out tonight that it was okay to mention it to you guys. So that's what I'm going to do. So yeah, so going out on tour with Grim Reaper, there's 17 tunes in the set, and I've got, I think, 11 of them right now, 11 or 12 of them. Pretty good. I've got a little ways to go. So after I get back from the IGPA summit, I've got, I think, a week and a half, and then I need to go out on tour with them. So I've got to finish the rest of those songs. Plus, I've got a new course coming out and tons of really fun stuff that I created for the guitar clubs and blah, 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 all kinds of stuff. You know, Austin, I think that was one of the places we were going to be playing, Brian, but I don't remember. There's a ton of shows in November, though. So anyway, so hopefully you guys will be able to come out and see me somewhere across the U.S. with Grim Reaper. So there you go. Thank you, John. Thank you. Thank you. Now, the dates that are on that link that John just posted, those links might change frequently. So you want to check back on that. There have been some dates that they've added and things like that. Jim says, I can't even memorize one song in 2 weeks. Don't feel bad. And so that was one thing I was going to talk to you guys about. If you are interested in how this works as a musician, you know, learning songs to play with another band or with people or something like that, I thought I would give you a little bit of insight on how I approach this. And because let's be honest here, I was a Grim Reaper fan back in the 80s, but it's not like I learned every one of their songs. I knew, you know, maybe three or four of their tunes that were kind of popular. I certainly didn't know 17 of them. And now they just had a new album that came out. So like 8 of the songs are brand new. Like nobody's ever heard them before until like last week when the album got released. So I'm trying to learn these old songs and then all these new songs. So I'm going to give you my kind of insight, and you'll probably see some videos that talk about this stuff a little more in depth, but I thought since we're hanging out anyway, I would tell you a little bit about this, and then you can approach learning songs the same way, and maybe it won't take you 2 weeks. So here's the deal. The first thing that I do is I listen through the songs, okay? And then I pick out the ones, as I'm just casually listening to them, I pick out the ones that seem like they're more simple in their organization, like they have less parts, right? So I try and find out of these 17 songs, I'm trying to find maybe 3 or 4 or 5 of them that are less structured. They don't have, not less structured, but less pieces to them, okay? So here's where it starts for me, guys. I'm driving around in my car, or I'm putting my headphones on or whatever late at night when my family goes to bed, and I'm just listening to the tunes, not deeply. I'm just listening to them to try and pick out which ones to start with. Maybe I've heard a song before, or these two songs, or these three songs. Those are the first ones I'm going to start with. Okay? So that's what I got first. And so then I go through and I start learning those two ways. Number one, by ear. Okay? So I'm listening to the songs by ear, picking out the parts. The second thing I do is I load these songs into a program called Amazing Slowdowner. Now, I know there's other programs out there that you can use, and if you use something else, that's awesome. But I use Amazing Slowdowner, and it's got a karaoke button on it. And what happens is when I click that, I can choose a different setting of the karaoke to try and get the vocals out of there so I can hear it a little bit more. Okay? And then I start picking it out and figuring out the song. Okay? Here's the second part to that that's really, really important, okay? I listen to the song over and over and over. And I know you guys have probably heard me talk about this before, but I call it focused listening, just like focused practicing. Not when I'm talking to my kids, or not when I'm trying to read directions to Denny's or something like that. I listen to the song. I take everything else out of my brain, and I just listen to that song. And then I listen to it again, and then I listen to it again. So now all of a sudden I take a song that maybe I've never heard, or I've heard a little bit, and I make it something that I know. Now I start putting a face to the name. I start putting the parts. To the song, and I start building it. That's how I learn songs, and that's how I learn a lot of songs in a short amount of time. So here's what happens. Now, night number 2 comes. Now I've got 4 songs that I know pretty good. So now I'll add 1 or 2 more songs that I don't know at all, and I'll go through the same process. I'll listen to them over and over and over. And now at this point, these aren't easy songs. Okay? These are the regular songs. So now I'm starting at the beginning of the set, and I'm going to take that first song, and I'm going to start bashing it down. I'm going to start learning it. Rock You to Hell, that's what that is, Jack. Yep. So the first song, I'm going to start wearing that down in my head, getting to know it. Then I start learning the parts to that song, okay? So now I've got these 4 over here that I pretty much know, but they're not perfect. And now I got a new one that's brand new, okay? So now night 3 comes, and now I've got to pick 1 or 2 new ones. So these, by that time, are starting to come around to being more polished. These are moving in the middle section. And now I got 2 or 3 new ones. Now it can get a bit insurmountable. And that's when you go, oh my gosh, I'm getting overloaded. Well, if that starts happening, you need to take a break, right? But that's how I learn songs. So not only do I have to learn the songs, but I have to learn them in order, and I have to learn how they tie together, because I can't be looking at a sheet going, well, you know, especially like if I said to you, what's a song that you, like, play a song you don't know. Well, you wouldn't be able to play it. So the first thing you got to do is you have to identify the intro of the song, right? You've got to hear the intro and go, oh, I know what that song is, okay? So there's lots of different songs like that that I'm learning how to do, and I've got about 11 or 12 of them right now. I've got 17 I need to do. Another one is this one. This, that is not by Grim Reaper, which is kind of fun because I've never done this one live. See if you know this one. Anybody know that one? Jake, I'm going to get to that question. That's a great question. That song, I'll give you 20 seconds here to see if anybody knows that song. And then when it kicks in, it goes. Dio. Yeah, it's Dio. It's Don't Talk to Strangers. So they do that song. Well, I love that song. It's a tribute. Steve, I wouldn't say he was friends with Dio, but he knew Dio. And so he does it in tribute for Dio. So I get to play that song. And just a little while ago, I think I posted a video or something on how to play that song just because it's so much fun to play. So so let's see here. Jake says, if there are two guitar parts, how do you know which one to learn? This is really, really important. That's a great question, Jake. You have to pick out the parts. There's two things about it. You've got to pick out the parts that people need to hear, because if they've heard the song before, they're expecting that part. And the second part is you need to play the parts that give the song a solid foundation. Okay? If you just play like all the lead parts, the song is going to sound super empty because in this case, I'm the only guitar player, right? So if I'm not playing the rhythm parts because I want to play a solo, then it's going to sound empty in that part. Okay. Now that's not always the case though. There might be a lick in a song that's really important that you play because it kind of defines the song. Okay. Now if we're talking about harmonies, Jake, harmonies are a different thing. Harmonies, either you're going to have a harmony pedal that you're going to use, or in my case, I am not bringing a harmony pedal. I got enough crap to learn the way it is without a harmony pedal. So if there's harmonies in the song, I'm just taking the main melody line and I'm playing that. Okay. If there's a main guitar part that I'm playing, and it's rhythmic, right? It's a rhythm part, and there's a melody over the top, I probably would throw the melody out and then play the main rhythm part, unless it's something that's really necessary, right? If I play, right, by Cowboys from Hell or Cowboys from Hell or something like that, I need that in there because people are expecting it, okay? So what the song really becomes, Jake, and anybody else who's asking, oh, sorry. Yeah, I do need to turn it up because I'm using a different input. So hold on one second. Can you guys kind of hear that? Hopefully you can hear that a little bit more. Okay, so if I'm playing a song that needs the melody, like there's something in there that needs to be there, okay, then I'm going to play that part and then go into the next part, okay? And then the other thing that I do, this is the last thing, is as I'm playing through the songs, if Don't Talk to Strangers, there's a Don't Talk to Strangers by Rick Springfield too, but this isn't the one. And then the last thing I do is I make notes on each one of the songs of parts that my brain keeps skipping, okay? For me, that's what I call it, is a hiccup, if you've ever heard me talking about those before. But a hiccup for me is a part in a song where I'm playing the song, and then all of a sudden it's black. Like I can't see what's coming next. And then I start stressing, right? Or I can kind of see what's coming, but I don't really know it, and then I get nervous. That's a hiccup for me, okay? So what happens is when I go to write down my notes, I don't write down the entire song. I just write down the hiccup spots. It might be how the intro starts or how the band ends it or whatever it might be. Yeah, it was You Give Love a Bad Name. And then I write down my hiccup points. And that's it. That's what I write down on a piece of paper. So I don't rely on that piece of paper. It's pentatonic. Yep. I don't rely on that piece of paper. I just I just use it for what I need it for. Okay? So it's a great learning process. And if you've never, you know, had to cram for a bunch of songs, I would recommend doing it someday because it's kind of neat. But anyway, so that's what we got going on. We got IGPA this weekend, Friday and Saturday. I told you about what's going on, the events for the day. I've got a new course coming out. I don't know when that's coming out. And the tour in November. And then the last thing, I suppose, which doesn't really matter for you, but I'm going to be having surgery on both my feet. I need to have surgery on both my feet. It's a long story, but I'm having my first surgery in January. So I'll be laid up with, I can't walk for 2 weeks, and then I get a boot for like 6 weeks or something like that. So I'll be doing video from my bed. I don't know what I'll be doing. I'll figure it out. So hopefully that helps you a little bit in understanding. Brian says, don't forget my t-shirt. Vic, hopefully that helps you and everybody else in kind of understanding how to approach cramming for songs. Because like for me to learn a song, the big thing is don't try and just like listen to a song and like try and learn it. Learn it piece by piece, right? Break it down. Break this piece down and this piece down and this piece. Listen to the song and get to know the song and eventually, you know, try and be able to memorize a song just like you do something that you love, like a song that you know, like Stairway to Heaven. You know it all the way through in your mind. You got to be able to do that. But then once you start learning it, you got to do it piece by piece. And if you get any of those little hiccup spots, then what you need to do is in those hiccup spots, you need to practice those more or make, you know, mental or physical notes so you can come back to it and remember what it is, which I wish I had my notes down here, but they're upstairs. So Greg says he had surgery on both his feet. Yeah. I'm not looking forward to it, so, but it's got to be done. So anyway, who out there on this call right now is coming to the webinar? Please say yes if you're coming, because I want to see your names on here. I'm getting super excited. Percocet, Paul says. I barely take ibuprofen, so I don't know how this is going to go. Let's see. Perfect. Yep. Awesome. So yeah, let me know. Are you coming? Are you coming to the IGPA summit? Let me know, because I am waiting to see you guys. Yes, yes, yes. Look at you. Yes. Awesome. Awesome. Look at you guys. Well, this is awesome. And listen, everybody. If for some reason you did not get your tickets to the IGPA, don't let that stop you. Don't worry about that. We'll take care of that. No worries. I know some people want to have the ticket just because they want to have the ticket, and we'll make sure you get them. But if for some reason you don't have one, don't you worry about it. Brian spent all his money on a Chapman stick. That's so awesome. Hey, I understand work. Don't worry about that. I know how it goes. So don't worry about it. I just want to see who's coming, because we're gonna hang out. Rita is excited. I am excited too. So Brian, can you hitch a ride with someone? Oh, this is good. Next year, Jose, I'm gonna hold you to that. Yeah, next year will be cool. I'll have a lot more time to plan for things, and I got all kinds of stuff going on in my brain that'll be cool. So. This is cool. All right. I'm so glad a bunch of you are coming. This is going to be really fun. Okay, guys, we're about halfway through this. I wanted to let you know what was going on with everything, what was going on in my world, which doesn't really make any difference because I'm more concerned with what's going on in your world. But I just wanted to let you know kind of what's happening, because if we can't hook up at the IGPA, maybe we can hook up at one of the Grim Reaper shows, because that would be so much fun. Okay. So if you're into Grim Reaper, you're into metal, and it's in your neighborhood, it would be super fun to come see you, because I won't know anybody else. So let's see here. Close to San Antonio. Brian, I don't know. I haven't even looked at the schedule. All I've had on my brain is summit. Summit, 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 summit. And then trying to learn songs so I'm not screwed the last week and can't learn all the material. I will not let them down. So when they asked me to do this, they were in a pinch because they needed a guitar player. I would go 5 days without sleep to learn these songs. So that won't happen. I will know the material, that's for sure. So, okay, cool. Let's see. What new bands do I like? Well, there's lots of new bands. I mean, I listen to more of the rock and metal genre. I like Monster Truck a lot. I don't know if anybody's into stoner metal, but Monster Truck is a pretty cool band. I kind of dig them. Let's see here. Tell me some of the bands that you guys like. This is one of the things I'm going to be trying to find out with you a little bit more, is trying to figure out what you like, okay? I want to keep making stuff for you. I want to keep teaching you how to do things, but I need to know you more personally of what you like, okay? Martina, Martina, you'll be there. You can tell me about your Blue Saraceno interview. That would be awesome, okay? Show Must Go On is not on the set list. Actually, we did that song with Grim Reaper a few years back with Steve. But no, the Show Must Go On is not on the set list. So give me some ideas, some new, fresh bands that you're listening to. Fresh bands, new bands. Alter Bridge, yeah. I don't know if I'd call them new, though. That's where I was kind of at, Shane, was I'm not sure if Alternate Bridge or Walter Trout or Kenny Wayne Shepherd are new. That's the problem. Because, like, I love bands like... Meshuggah. I don't know if anybody listens to Meshuggah or Devin Townsend or, Amon Amarth. I really like that kind of stuff. I love, like Todd says, Monster Truck, Hard Southern Rock. I love that kind of stuff. But they're not really new. You know, they're not new. So I'm not sure what new is anymore. I'm not new, so I'm not sure what that is. But will I be at the Toronto show on October 30th? No, I won't start until November. Mark says Winery Dogs. Yeah, they'd be kind of newer. Chevelle is not really new, though. Linkin Park, not really new. Trivium, I love Trivium. Let's see. Yeah, that's the thing, is I don't even know what really new is anymore. Amon Amarth is kind of new. Your own band, Fallen. Well, Brian, you'll have to send me a link because I've never heard your band before, but I would absolutely, absolutely listen to you for sure. So my favorite new artist is Harmer Superstar. Harmer Superstar. I'm going to have to look that up. I don't know what that is. Is that a band or a person? Harmer Superstar. King Kling. Monster Truck Wednesday. Yeah, Wednesday 13, I like them too. They're not new though. Heaven Below, I don't know them, Martina. Yeah, that's the thing, is I'm always open to something new, and it certainly doesn't have to Decipher Down, yeah. New Metallica is pretty good. I agree with that. Okay, I got a question for you. Let me see if I can find this. I probably already lost it. Oh, crap. I'm not going to find it either. There's this blues guy who everybody seems to have heard of but me, and he plays old school blues. And he is, please let it be in here. Oh, he's not in here. Something Junior. It seems like they're all named something Junior. But I'm telling you, this guy was incredible. And a student was telling me about him. New Glenn Hughes coming out, by the way. I don't know if anybody's into Glenn Hughes, but he's got a new one coming out, which is Harmar Superstar, named after Harmar Mall. Okay, I'll have to check. No, not Bonamassa. No. He's way less known than that. And it's like Carl something or something Carl Jr. or... God dang it, that sucks. Because he was going to be my flight music, too. Oh, man. Gary Clark Jr. Thank you, Todd. Gary Clark Jr. Have you guys heard this dude? Holy crap, he's good. He's super, super good. Gary Clark Jr., thank you. I got to add that in right now, as a matter of fact. Gary Clark Jr. I am not kidding. I don't know if you all get into blues, but holy crap, he's good. Is that what you wanted, Brian? Yeah, Gary Clark Jr. Have you guys heard Gary Clark Jr.? That is inspiring. Holy buckets, that guy is really fun. Really fun to listen to. Yeah. So I'm evidently really late on the Gary Clark Jr. bus. Jim says he saw him 3 years ago. Yeah, well, see, PJ, that's what I'm saying. I'm behind on the Gary Clark Jr. I didn't know. I don't remember where I was talking to somebody, and they're like, yeah, have you heard of Gary Clark Jr.? I'm like, no. I'm like, you are missing out. And I was listening to the live album and was just astonished. But right now my brain is so full of songs, you know, because then I learn songs all the time in church, and my daughter and I just did another show, and so my brain's had a lot of stuff on it. But Gary Clark Jr., that's what I'm going to be doing. Okay, cool. So we got Gary Clark Jr. Anybody else? Let's see. Oh, yeah, no, that's, I thought you were talking about Hair of the Dog, so. That's what I thought you were talking about. So if it was a band, then I don't know. So, but if you are talking about, if anybody's ever talking about Nazareth, Nazareth was one of my favorite bands of all time, and I actually got to open with them and hang out with them, which was really fun. So anyway, yeah. Danny Ratcliffe, yeah, absolutely. Austin Young, PJ, there's another one. PJ, is this another Austin Young? Is that another blues person? Austin Young. Okay, well, I gotta check these out. Yeah, I gotta write this down too. Austin Young. Austin Young. It sounds like a blues name. It's a band? Okay, Brian says it's a band. Okay. I'll look that up. Okay. Holiday. Yeah. See, that's the thing, is there's so many bands out there. And I just had a conversation, which maybe we'll do over a few beers on Friday night anyway, but about the state of the music industry and how there's so many bands out there, and it's so hard to get to know them because you're just inundated with artists all the time. See, I listen to a lot of contemporary Christian stuff too nowadays. So I don't really like the really, really mellow stuff. I get more into, you know, like Lincoln Brewster and some of the guitar heavy guys like that. But Pretty Reckless, I like Pretty Reckless, which brings me then, Michael, to In This Moment. I don't know if you get into In This Moment, but In This Moment is a great band. Great live show, really cool people. In This Moment is cool. Okay, Art of Anarchy. Yeah, with Bumblefoot, yep. Yep, Art of Anarchy. Art of Anarchy? I thought Art of Anarchy was supposed to have, what's his name from Anthrax in it? Dan Spitz. Maybe not. Jake says Striper. I'm a huge Striper fan. I got a bunch of really fun Striper photos I'll have to post someday. Yeah, Art of Anarchy, Lance, I know what you're talking about. For some reason, I thought Danny was in there, but maybe he's not. So, oh, Brian, I get you now. I get you. Oh, Michael just said he just saw them at Louder Than Life. Yeah. Yeah, they still sound awesome for sure. See, and this is good. This is why we got to get together. We got to talk about these things. We got to listen to some music. This will be fun. Scott says Disciple, Switchfoot, and Red. Red, I don't know. Switchfoot and Disciple, I know. I did a show with, it was another metal Christian band. Oh, man. My brain is not doing very well. Okay, so anyway, Phil Keaggy, yes, absolutely. Phil Keaggy is one of the greatest ever. So, and that's another thing I like to listen to, is just like finger picking stuff, acoustic stuff, instrumental stuff. I really enjoy that sort of thing too. Icon for Hire, Todd says. I'll have to look up Icon for Hire too, because I don't know them either. Okay, so those of you that are coming, this is what we need to talk about. Okay, we need to share some music stories. Butcher Babies, yeah, Butcher Babies is getting more popular. They're not really my cup of tea, but I can certainly see how they would be popular for sure. Tourniquet, yep, Tourniquet. I'm trying to remember. Demon Hunter, that's who I played with, Demon Hunter. I opened for Demon Hunter. I don't know if anybody knows Demon Hunter out there, but I opened for them. Okay, cool. I got a link from Marcos I can check out. Audio Adrenaline. Yeah, I like Audio Adrenaline. Newsboys, that sort of thing. Yep. Brian says, sign don't me good. You are absolutely 1 million percent correct, Brian. Especially nowadays, that doesn't mean anything. And the other thing we could talk about sometime too, Brian says, help me with the stick, is this whole popularity thing. You know, there's so many really great bands that you're going to see that are not in a dome or something like that. You know, we get this misconception. And then the other thing is we get this misconception about artists that they've got albums out there making millions of dollars, and it couldn't be further from the truth. A lot of the artists you're naming right now work hard. You know, they travel around and they work hard, and they don't get a lot of sleep, and they don't sleep in hotels every night, and set up their own gear oftentimes. I just saw a post from Anthrax where they were cleaning up after a show at some theater that they had to clean up after because it was in the stipulations. So I thought that was kind of funny, which is kind of neat. Guys, you guys have so many stories. This is awesome. Okay. Yeah, we have it's closing, unfortunately, but in Minneapolis, there's a club called Mill City Nights, and Mill City was just the place to go see all the cool bands. And unfortunately, at the end of this month, they're closing. Lots of venues closed down, and there's just less and less places to see bands. Rick Emmett. Now, Rick Emmett is another one that I really, really enjoy. I haven't heard anything from him in a long time, but that doesn't mean he hasn't been doing stuff. It just, I might be out of the loop. So guys, is there, just so I make sure that I'm not boring anybody, which some of you are probably out there going, dear God, stop talking about music. Stu Hamm is on a minivan tour right now. I'm telling you, this is the way it goes. You know, we think that all these bands are on Learjets and all this sort of thing. Those days don't really necessarily exist so much anymore. So this Grim Reaper thing is going to be really fun because it gives us an opportunity to hang out together and in close quarters and play in clubs. They're all clubs. Every one of those shows is in a club, so in a smaller club. And Steve is just, like I said, is one of my best friends in the world. So it'll be really, really fun to be playing with him and making people smile. So that'll be cool. And I hope that some of you come out to some of the shows. I hope you can get out there, find a way to get out there. So let's see. So should all the IGPM members head up at a local guitar center after the meet and greet and jam out? I think they'll be closed by then. They don't want us breaking in. John says, what? Stop talking about music? That's right, John. That's good stuff. See, I'm telling you, this stuff right now, you can see the smile on my face. This is the stuff that keeps you inspired to keep practicing, to keep playing. Okay? It's not about all the other stuff you thought when you were 13. It's about playing and having fun and being with people that you enjoy and making music. And as long as you can always keep this about being fun. You know, there was a stage in my life when I was touring a lot and I was gone all the time from my family and I was making pretty darn good money, and for a band anyway. And it just got to be stale because we did the same songs over and over and over. And one of the best things that ever happened to me, even though I loved the guys I played with, was not doing it anymore and getting on to some other bands. Less audiences, more personable, more intimate, and the audiences that we did play for really, 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 really loved what we did. And that was really cool. And all of a sudden it wasn't about the money anymore. It was about playing. And that's what I do now. It's just about playing. So the Grim Reaper thing is exactly that. I'm getting paid for it, but honestly, even if I didn't really get paid for it, I'd be doing it anyway because it sounds like a frickin' blast. So please always keep that in mind when you when you're practicing. You know, you need to find people out there to play with and have some fun. I don't care if it's in a basement, if it's in a garage, if it's at a church, if it's at a coffee shop. You know, Preston just said, you got to love the music, not the money. That's exactly right. I'm not saying you can't go through a transition where, you know, because touring, there's something to be said about playing a lot. You know, when you play 3, 4, 5 nights a week, your chops are in better shape than they probably ever could be. And your stage presence, you learn about stage presence, you learn about, you know, the band and the cues and the mistakes and all those kind of things. You learn a lot of things. And even the stuff before and after, setting up and tearing down and driving and traveling and, you know, all those kind of things really, really do something to that I loved for years. I loved it. It's just, you know, now I'm in a place where now I like to tour a little and then I like to be home. And like I said, because I don't have to do it for money per se, I can do what I want to do or what me and my group, my group of people that I'm going to play with would like to do. So it's less about how many people can we draw and is more about, can we do something that made people go, wow, that was really awesome. Thank you so much. And, you know, definitely come back and see you again, that sort of thing. Jonathan says, you know, Nazareth lead singer would have been a better match to fill in. Yes, but he had a heart attack, Jonathan, and he, well, at least the original lead singer, and he's not playing with him anymore. He's not playing at all. So they got a younger dude that's singing for him now. But anyway, let's see. Yep. So you guys all have some really good, and that's what I'm saying. I'm excited to meet you and talk about these things. We can get together, have some beers and tell some stories about things. And you know, Glenn will be there and he'll have all kinds of fun Megadeth and King Diamond and Testament stories. And Griff will be there and tell you about his whole thing, which is really, really neat. So my future goal with GuitarZoom someday would be able to see you more. To be able to do something where we can get together more and you can stay inspired and we can play together, we can jam together, we can perform together, we can do different things and get you from out of your room playing, if that's what you're doing, and into an interactive element. And if you already play, just keep boosting your confidence, keep pushing you to a new level. Because that's one of the biggest things, guys, everybody on this call, is your confidence. It's not whether or not you're the best player or not, because you'll never be the best player. There's no such thing. But it's having confidence in what you're doing. So, cool. All right, guys, I tell you what, I hope this was fun for you. It was certainly fun for me. And I hope to see a lot of you in less than a week. Okay, come Friday, I want to see your faces. I want to see you. Let's hang out and just have some fun. And then Saturday, we're going to do some learning. Okay. Let's see. Jeremy's got a question. He says, you ever have that super I'm lost moment on stage when you have to fumble like crazy to get back on track? A million times, Jeremy. And as a matter of fact, the band that I'm talking about that I used to travel with a lot, they didn't have set lists. And it was the first band I'd ever played with that didn't have set lists. We had baseball cues. Okay. So this meant something or this meant something. And then what would happen is the leader of the band would play songs, he would start a song and it would be in a different key. Or we would play a song. One of the tricks that we would do, this is so awesome. It was terrifying at the time, but we would drive to a show, and this wasn't every night, but we would drive to a show and a song would come on the radio and it was something that you'd heard before, but you hadn't played before. And he'd go, okay, everybody be quiet. And you'd listen to the song. I am not lying to you. You'd listen to the song on the radio. Everybody would listen and shut up. And you figure out what you think the song is doing, whatever key, whatever the riff is, whatever. And then that night you'd sound check with it and play it that night as a test to see if you could do it. And of course you'd miss parts and you wouldn't play the whole song or whatever it might be. And we would do that on a regular basis. And it was terrifying because you didn't get to listen to the song 50 times. You got to listen to it one time. Now, again, it wasn't something that was really, really tough or had 75 parts or a Dream Theater song or something like that. It might be Go for a Soda, or it might be, you know, some song by Rick Springfield that you've heard before, but you've never played or something like that. And then you try that night for sound check. You'd organize, what key do we want this in? You put it in a key and you play it. So have I had those moments a million times? Again, I think I talk about this in Songfire, but about clearing songs. But for me, that's what a song is I clear songs. And what I do is I listen to a song to the point where I don't see the song in its entirety out in front of me. Okay. I don't have, you know, 60 songs in an evening, which is very possible to play. I don't see every one of them sitting out there, but I can see them as I'm driving through the song, as I'm playing through the song. And every time I move along, I can see the next part. It's like driving up to a stop sign and then seeing the road, right? You've already assessed that the road is going this way or whatever. I do the same thing with songs. If there's a part in the song that's black, then I'm going to have to cheat my way through, fake my way through, improv my way through, dive bomb my way through, whatever I got to do to make this work to get back in. But then the next time around, I'll make sure that I clear that song again so I don't have that part. Go for a soda. Yeah, Go for a Soda is one of my favorite songs ever. And learning how to play that and sing that at the same time was insanity, because they're not doing the same thing at all. So in that aspect, the song itself wasn't that hard, but learning how to play it and sing it was something I had to practice a lot, which is a whole nother discussion to have. So anyway, everybody, have a wonderful evening. Thank you so much for being here. Take care and travel safe. If you're coming to the IGPA this weekend, travel safe, and I will see you on Friday. All right. So take care, stay positive, and keep practicing. Really, really important. Okay. Everybody take care. Bye. God bless you.